Thank you, Takao. It's a pleasure to be here. Yes, 20 years ago. I know how to select unfriendly places. Is that right? Harvard and Hopkins. They have a reputation not being very friendly. But anyway, no, they are great places for science and for everything. Actually, I train also at Children's Hospital, so I am back home. And when I was approached about giving this lecture, I thought, what can I talk about? And I work on a number of disorders, very specific disorders, as well as in the issue of intellectual disability and autism in general. So I decided to talk about fragile X. And the reason is because I think that if this is one of your first exposures to what is medicine and going right now in the context of neuroscience and developmental neuroscience, fragile X offers a number of lessons. And I have been long enough to have seen part of the history of this. And you can see some of the gray hair is a testimony of that. And the first issue is that everyone is very excited when the gene is discovered. And it seems to be the end of the journey. In many ways, it is the end of a journey. Now we have the identification of the cause or the main cause. Not always syndrome is matched one-to-one to a gene. And with that, we can create animal models, and usually are mouse models, but there are other animals that have been used. Actually, we're moving to rat models of this type of disorders. There are drosophila models, et cetera. So we can start understand the biology of the disease to the extent that the animal model can mimic or provide the foundation for understanding what is happening in humans. But at the same time, there is a new journey that starts. It's one that is much more precise, much more focused, and one with this full of challenges. In 1991, after a tremendous effort, of several laboratories, and this was a combined publication from a group at Emory University, another one at Erasmus University in Rotterdam and the Netherlands, the fragile X gene was identified. In the X chromosome, all the assumptions were pretty much correct. In fact, it's a long history from the early days of analysis of chromosome under a microscope, which you can imagine it's not a very high power type of analysis, all the way to the molecular era that started in the 80s, all that journey to identify the gene. I'm not going to talk a lot about the gene, but what I'm going to mention is what have we learned by identifying the gene. Number one, we have identified that the individual who have the mutation, and this is a very unique mutation, actually have a tremendous range of abnormalities and very variable clinical presentation. So the most obvious one, and one is the one that puts fragile X at the top of any public health issue, is that it's the most common inherited cause of intellectual disability. Intellectual disability is a new term that we use for mental retardation. We don't use mental retardation any longer. And the only other genetic cause, the other genetic etiology or cause that is more frequent is Down syndrome, which Down syndrome is sporadic, it's not inherited. It turns out that it's also fragile X syndrome is the most common. This is the number one cause of autism. Now, the relative impact of fragile X and autism has been decreasing, in part because we have a different way to capture patients with autism, to do genetic testing, and from an initial assumption that was about 5% of autism, it had been now down to 2 or 3%. Nonetheless, is the top cause, because no other genetic or any other etiology of autism even reaches more than 1%. So it's important because of that. But I think the fascinating thing from the scientific point of view is how can you go from a single homogeneous genetic abnormality, 99.5% of the patients, some estimates are even and 99.9% of the patients had the same mutation. Yet, although most of them have some intellectual impairment, a few are in the normal, low normal range of cognition, they have a variety of behavioral problems. ADHD, attention deficit disorder. I am thinking that you are familiar with children with learning problems, so you will be interested in this issue. You have autism, you have anxiety. We are going to go in a little bit more detail to that. How is it possible? Single gene. In fact, it's such a challenge that while most of disorders are diagnosed on what we call clinical basis, the combination of signs and symptoms, in the case of Fragile X, is an exception. It's diagnosed genetically. So you suspect based on the symptom and other behavioral problem like ADHD, you say, well, a child with ADHD who has not normal cognition, there are issues about the family history I'm going to mention in a little while. I mean, you come up with an idea and you order the test. But many times, there is no way to predict. So that's the reason why the testing for Fragile X has been built in these sort of screening programs. Children with intellectual disability. Actually, this week, a couple of days ago, we were discussing, we're putting internal guidelines at Children's Hospital about how to do genetic testing is cost efficient. We don't want to start spending, you can spend easily $10,000 in tests. And also the aggravation of multiple blood draws. I mean, you could imagine what it is for a child with so many problems, including sensory problem. We want to be cost efficient. And where are we going to put Fragile X? Fragile X had to be there. We do only the boys, or we also do the girls. This is our dilemma to be on one hand sensitive, but at the same time specific. Now, interestingly enough, after all the discovery of the gene, and I have witnessed this with two disorders, Fragile X and Rett syndrome, at the very early stage of my career, both genes, or main genes, because in the case of Rett syndrome, there are other genes, there's not only one, but one accounts for most cases, were discovered. And I have seen the transformation of the field, even things that had nothing to do with genetics, which is to try to understand cognitive profiles, are much easier, or people are more interested in doing it. And people who do other things, who are not in the field, say, oh, wow, that could be an interesting disorder. I'm a cognitive neuroscientist. I'm going to try to understand what's going on there. So we have come to know a few years, maybe 5 years after the gene was identified, that there is a particular problem with nonverbal function. And actually, it's probably one of the best genetic models of math disability. And this is something I know very little, but I know other people are working very hard on that. Now, interestingly enough, anxiety seems to be, and particularly social anxiety, seems to be almost like a trait. In other words, these children are either shy or so shy that they cross the threshold to being socially anxious, particularly the boys. So all those things are fascinating and complicated, and you will think that discovering the gene was the end of the journey. But there are other surprises. In 2000, almost 10 years after the gene was discovered, a new disease was identified linked to the Fragile X gene, not to the same mutation that produces Fragile X syndrome. Is clinicians were, in several parts of the country, were hearing too frequently the story that these children had grandfathers or great uncles who had Parkinson, or something, maybe they have Alzheimer's, it's not clear. Or stories like, oh, my granddad really wanted to get to the appointment, but really he cannot go upstairs. I mean, there should be an elevator in every hospital. For some reason, some people even found that information, said, wait a minute, there's something going on here. And a new disorder, which the name tells you the symptoms. There's tremor, like in Parkinson's disease. There's ataxia, which is a cerebellar problem, like someone who has had a little bit too many beers. And this syndrome is associated with declining cognitive function. And this happens in older males who are carrying the mutation. And I'm going to explain what is to be a carrier. Well, shortly after this, people started looking at more in detail the carriers. There have been a lot of concerns about the mothers being affected. But they said, well, having a child with intellectual disability, with autism, is enough to make everyone very emotional and very, you know, not behaving properly. But there seems to be much more than that. There is something to be specific. And this massive testing for Fragile X in the case of autism has shown that many kids with autism and some with ADHD have carrier status. Is it really because this is relatively a frequent situation, or it really is a cause-effect relationship? So let me tell you about what happened in the gene. And this is a fascinating story because the typical gene, let's look at this, this cartoon. The gene, it has, I don't know how much you know about genes, but the gene has 17 exons. Exon 1, the first exon, is next to one of the regulatory regions of the gene. And regulatory regions of the gene now, we thought that were at the beginning, in the head or the tail of the gene, but now they are everywhere. It's becoming very confusing. But assuming that one of the prime regions for regulatory, you know, components of the gene is the head, the proximal region. In the proximal region, there is in between exon 1 and the promoter, sort of the main switch that turns the gene on and off, there is a variable region in which there's some is what we call a polymorphism, and it has this configuration, CGG repeats. It's CGG, 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 CGG. So in the general population, the average number of CGGs is about 30. It's a wide range. There's 10 to all the way to 40, 45. That's considered the range. So these regions seem to be very unstable. And over the course of time and generation, for reasons that we don't fully understand, expands in the next generation. So typically, the boys who have Fragile X syndrome, which is an X-linked disorder, we're talking about something happening in the X chromosome. Boys have only one X chromosome, so it comes from mom. And a mother with premutation, with this expansion, in which this number of 45 goes all the way up to 200, but not beyond 200, transmit this X chromosome to the boys, and the boys inherit this X chromosome, and it gets even bigger, and it goes above 200. And when it goes above 200, the mechanism of surveillance of something wrong with DNA, this is bad, you know, we had to put an end to this because mutations could give origin to cancer. We have this mechanism to say, oh, this is wrong. And it comes and it methylates the gene. Actually methylates the promoter, and it methylates this region expanded, which is very similar. The promoter is an island, it's a CBG island, and CG repeats are the places where methylation takes place. Methylation is really, in simplistic terms, a switch that turns on and off genes. It's not that simple, but you know, that's at the basic level. So if we have a cell in the stomach, that cell in the stomach has all the genes in the body, including the genes that the cells in the brain have. And you want the cell in the stomach to be an efficient producer of, let's say, acid. You don't want them to be too smart. They don't want to be, you know, if they become like a hippocampal or cortical, not good. So how do they do that? They turn off the gene that are tissue specific. You know, they don't want to produce neurofilaments and other things that neurons have. So those are the promoters. And in most genes that you need in every cell, and this is one of them, this is it has been called a housekeeping gene because it had to be in most cells functioning. In most cells, these promoters are open. They are not methylated because you want the gene to be expressed in the cell to do whatever it does, produce a protein that is important for the cell. So this isn't, for that reason, this is not what it should happen. So the gene is turned off. And that's the reason why it's called atypical methylation. And it happened at that almost magic threshold of 200 CG repeats. And thanks to some European countries like the Netherlands, where there are long family histories and pedigree, we have been able to track, you know, how this process occurs among generations. Actually, a colleague of mine who is a molecular geneticist and epidemiologist at Emory discovered this, Stephanie Sherman. It's called the Sherman paradox. And she always reminds that she doesn't want to be called a paradox. She wants to be called Stephanie. Yeah, okay, so it's Stephanie Sherman, not the Sherman paradox. But so the consequence of this is relatively simple. The gene is turned off. And there are a lot of complexities in genetics in which the sequence of a gene is changed, and maybe the conformation of the protein is going to change. And it's very difficult to predict what it's going to do. Now, with all the knowledge that we have regulatory regions in the middle of the gene, and you could imagine all the different combinations. In this case, Fragile X is very straightforward. If you have less than 200 repeats, the gene is functional. If you have more than 200, it's turned off. And it doesn't work. There is no message. There is no protein. Now, that was until the late 90s. So by then, and because of the identification of FACTAS, this specific syndrome affecting the grandfathers and great uncles of these boys with Fragile X, it was discovered that actually individuals who have premutation, that's the name of the carrier status, which includes the mothers of the boys, the males, these males who have premutation, they were not affected with Fragile X, and they were known to be the ones that passed the premutation to their daughters. So there was known this. This is part of the Sherman paradox. These are the transmitting males. And it turned out that if you look at carefully enough, these transmitting males, a large proportion of them, when they reach age 50, and particularly 60, begin to show symptoms of this disorder. And actually, a study done in Northern California has shown the longer they live, the more likely that they present symptoms of FACTAS. So there are other things that have been discovered also. There is a problem with ovarian function, and this is essentially premature menopause. I'm not going to get into that. But what seemed to be the problem, and we don't know exactly the mechanism, the simplistic explanation because there is an expansion, maybe the message was too large and got sort of stuck in the ribosomes and didn't make the protein at the right quantity, and that's the reason why a feedback loop is saying we need to make more message because we're not making enough protein. Apparently it's not the reason, but nonetheless, this accumulation of message is become toxic. And this message, this mRNA, and you know mRNAs have all type of stability. An mRNA, for instance, for a structural protein and actin is very stable. An mRNA for a cytokine that needs to act very quickly is very short-lived. But RNAs can stick around, and these RNAs get into complexes with proteins, sequester them, and at the end, it looks like any neurodegenerative disorder. It looks like all the inclusion that you see in Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson, and so on. Bad news. So from one disorder, now we have at least two major. And what happens with the children who have autism and have premutation? We don't know. None of them has reached 50 or 60 to know what is happening with them. So this is the typical family history of one of the family with Fragile X. So here you have the typical boy with Fragile X syndrome, an IQ of 50, more than 200 repeats, silence gene. He has autism. There is another boy here who has premutation. And the IQ is much higher, and the child has autism, and he has a ton of mRNA. And here you have a girl who has full mutation. So in X-linked disorders, obviously males are more affected because they have only one. There is no compensation. And we assume that there is what we call a balanced X inactivation. So the extra X chromosome that the ladies have had to be turned off. To have too much of something in genetics is not good. Down syndrome is the best example. You have three copies of the chromosome 21. Not good for you. So nature knows and it turns off or inactivates one of the X chromosomes randomly. Sometimes it's not so randomly, so that leads to variation in the phenotype because depending on whether the X chromosome that carries the mutation is inactivated or the one that is normal is how severely affected you are. But this is a typical story of a female. This will be a girl or a woman with a full mutation. 350, gene is turned off in one chromosome. In the other one is 29. So she has a good gene. Let's assume that it's 50-50 and she has equal number of each one. Her IQ is 75. It's not the best, but it's still in the normal range. It's barely. And she has attention deficit disorder. She has this nonverbal learning disability, particularly math disability. And she has anxiety. So this is the younger generation. If you go all the way back to males, this square represents males. Here is the grandfather. The grandfather with premutation, more than 45, less than 200. Good IQ, 115. A lot of mRNA, which is toxic. He makes FMRP. He doesn't have fragile X, but he has this bad condition. And in between, you see a lot of other things. So this has become a multi-generational disease. And all the pictures that I'm showing, by the way, are a picture that the families have allowed to be displayed for teaching purposes at the, there are two foundations, two advocate groups, and they have a very nice website if you want to read more about it. Yes?
Yeah. How does, like, if you have two parents with like 85 and then 30, and they produce a child, a boy with 450 repeats? How does it look? What's the biology of that? Like on the top, the two parents.
These are the grandparents.
Oh, the grandparents.
Yeah. Okay. The mother had the typical expansion.
Okay.
So from 85, mom, slightly expansion. But this is where the jump happened, and we don't know why. From 92 to 450. And that's the typical expansion that you see. Granddad with premutation, mom with premutation, grandchild, boy, full mutation. Yes?
So the mechanism for increasing the number of repeats is not known at all?
Yeah. Well, there are many hypotheses, but it's not really known. So here we are. One gene, different disorders. It's the same gene, different mutations, different stages of the mutation. This, imagine this like a stage-by-stage mutation. Yes? I'm sorry, someone had a question.
I saw this premutation expansion from one generation to the next going through the line from grandpa.
It doesn't happen from males to females. It happens from females to males. Mm-hmm. We don't know why.
Is there any incidences of it becoming less, or does it always expand?
Contraction, no. No, it's a margin because actually it's more like the technical problem with PCR quantifying. No, it's not more, even that. You go back, maybe this is a technical issue, whether it's 85 or 92, it's almost identical. This is significantly different. So, I already mentioned this. This is a fascinating story, and actually, to make it more complicated, there is a group that statistically is at the edge between normal and premutation that we have been following, and we don't know what it means. Actually, the reason why this group is of interest because there have been some reports that they behave as a premutation. So women who have, let's say, 45 may have children, boys who have 200. But it's unclear. It's still under investigation. So my journey into Fragile X, like many things in life, it was a little bit by chance. But starting the lab, I started asking questions for which obviously they were not answered. And it happened that I became involved in 1995. So I started my journey in 1995, 4 years after the gene was identified. And to show you, this is the reason why it's called Fragile X. And that's the X chromosome, that's the tip of the X chromosome. If you culture cells taken from blood, you put them in the right medium, and you want to look at the chromosome spread, actually, under certain conditions, boom, the tip breaks, and that's the reason why it's called Fragile X. It's actually the only way that was diagnosed the condition until 1991. And this is the southern blot. This is the way the southern blot is done. And I want to mention this. You see like a smear, like someone had painted. Actually, that's the way it is. When you look at in detail the populations, you don't see a single number. You see the number, this is not, southern blot is not the best method to quantify the expansion. It's much better PCR. But having said that, what you have is a wide range of expansion. So it's like cells are at different stages. And you could imagine that this is a process in which the average population is, let's say, 250. But there are some a little bit less, some a little more. And it's an ongoing process that showed the very unstable nature of that region of the genome. But this is where I came to the picture. And I wanted to look at the protein, because ultimately, the important thing is whether the protein is done or is made or not made. And I told you in Fragile X, it's off. It turned off and there's no protein. So I developed the Western blot assay. This is southern blot is for DNA, northern blot is for RNA, and Western blot is for protein, in which I developed this protocol. And using the antibody that was available at that time. So I defined the patterns, and actually these patterns are very easy to see without even quantification. Actually, I trained people to recognize the nature of the problem. Here you see this line. So this is the other complication of Fragile X. I told you all the things that are, in the view of genetics, relatively simple when a gene is turned on and off. But the story is not very simple. This gene is alternatively spliced. So you can have multiple ways in the mRNA is edited, is you know, cut in different ways to generate multiple protein forms, which are called isoforms, typically between 8 and 12. And you say, well, that makes sense. Some isoform is for the brain, some isoform is for the lymphocytes, some isoform is for the stomach. Actually, it's not that simple like that. People are still looking for that. And actually, it's very interesting because I review grants for the NIH, and I used to see a lot of grants about this topic. Visually, I haven't reviewed one in several years. The problem shows you how the problem is so complicated. So there are multiple isoforms, and this is what you typically see in lymphocytes. Now, this is someone who makes a tiny bit of the protein. And what you see is the most abundant isoform here is the only one they see. And this line here, what is that? Actually, that line is actually an FMRP. That's the name of the protein, a homolog. It turns out there are other two proteins coded for by genes which are not on the X chromosome, which have very similar properties. And because they have similar properties, it has molecular homology, and the antibody I was using actually cross-reacts. And so not by design, this is a monoclonal antibody, which supposedly is more specific, but this is the head of the protein, the N-terminal region. It turned out to be homolog with FXR1. So actually what you see here is FMRP and FXR1, and here in someone with full mutation, you see only FXR1. And one thing that we published is that you can see here there's more. So there seemed to be an attempt to compensate for the deficit in FMRP. We published this about 10 years ago, but the attempt is seen to be very, very mild and not very efficient. And this is a cartoon to say, you know, males are different from females. Sorry. Trying to be funny. I have discovered that the best way to be funny is to make fun of yourself. Nobody's unhappy. Yeah. Nobody complains, but you know, sometimes you need more material. I presented you a story which is fascinating. We developed the fMRP assay and we use it in order to look at the relationship between phenotype and genotype. With the understanding that maybe some individuals are not completely silenced due to the smear, that some make a little bit of protein. And the story is true. Let me go back to the paper. That paper was published in 1999. So it was, when was that? This year or last year? I don't remember, I think probably 2011. I was watching the Grammy Awards. And that's a time when nobody can interrupt me because music is very important for me. And I had my laptop with me, and I don't know why I had the email. It's like being always on. It was a Sunday evening, as you know, Grammy, and I see this desperate email from a colleague who usually doesn't send me emails. I say, okay, I'm going to read it. And he has reread the paper more than 10 years later. I said, I think there is, you were right. He was polite. He wasn't saying your Western blood method is, and your quantitation were not very good. He said, well, we have actually observed the same. I'm a little bit surprised. Why are you surprised if we already published it? Well, okay, you draw conclusions about that. That's okay. I actually have a patent on this, and it's a patent that never have produced a penny because the problem with this is that make it not a very good diagnostic test. But they found the same variability that we found in 1999. And that variability, I think, unfortunately, has now led to a big disappointment. There is a recent clinical trial with a drug which is an antagonist of NGLUR5, which is a type of glutamate receptor. It's a type of, it's called metabotropic. This is the most common metabotropic glutamate receptor in the brain. It's in the regions that are to do with cognition, high level processing like cortex, hippocampus, amygdala, and so on. And it's called mGluR5. And to make a long story short, it has been shown there is too much mGluR activity in fragile X. I'm not going to touch this issue, but I wanted simply to mention that this observation now has become a very interesting one because in another paper that we published a couple of years later, we showed there is a group that actually makes a tiny bit of protein, tiny bit. And we couldn't, phenotypically, the mosaics like these tend to be less affected because they have protein, tend to have higher IQ, fewer problems, exactly as genetic will predict. And they're a mosaic because they have a relatively lower number of cells that went from pre-mutation to full mutation, not every cell. But we discovered something in between these two groups, in between those two. And we didn't give it a name. And that those patients do not respond to the mGluR5 antagonist. In the clinical trial that was published about a year ago or a year and a half ago, that group didn't respond. They had to be completely silenced like this. We don't know what, but the journey for molecular and phenotypic variability keeps going on. So that's the reason why my colleague was interested. He, when he saw that paper, was published in January, that had to be 2011, because he sent me the email in February when the Grammys are. So he had, what's going on? And then he discovered the paper and said, oh, this those group that makes a little bit. Yes?
I was curious if the individuals have a cellular mosaic where there's, you know, some of their cells are pretty, you know, more afflicted or have greater number of insertions, so the CGG,
yeah,
is what I would call, and then some of the cells have fewer. Does that mean that the multiplicity factor must occur during development as opposed to sort of at the ova level?
Yeah, the evidence is that it happened during the early, very early stages of the embryo. That's the time when the expansion, yes. And also when the methylation takes place. So the expansion and the methylation. Yeah, so you have, actually not one cell has two, it's simply different cells, and then which proportion of the cell have one what we call allele and one or gene, and the other has a different allele. But let me go back to this because the purpose of this talk was mainly to talk about the clinical issues, and I don't want to go too molecular, but there are molecular things. So this is the phenotype. This is the fascinating phenotype. Mild, moderate, in that range, rarely you see severe or profound intellectual disability, ADHD, autism, social withdrawal anxiety. Sometimes it's difficult to define is autism or is anxiety. Sometimes you see general anxiety disorder rather than social. For the most part, it's social. Aggressive behavior, hyperreactivity to stimuli, particularly auditory, but also visual and tactile. And then you have the non-neurophenotype. You have this prominent chin, prominent forehead, which are very characteristic. This actually is there are two children from here, from the Boston area. This is where the headquarters of one of the foundation, the Fragile X Research Foundation, and these are the children from the couple that founded this entity. This is the boy, who by now probably is in his late teens, and this is the girl, much less affected. And they have, to show you, it's a housekeeping gene, so you say, why you are not mentioning something outside the brain? I am mentioning, because actually there are other problems. There are connective tissue problems. They have very lax joints. They can have mitral valve prolapse, which tend to be mild for the same reason. They have strabismus, probably it's unclear what's the reason. They have recurrent and otitis media. They have, it's almost a rule that boys, when they are between 2 and 5, they have frequent ear infections. And when they are younger, in the first couple of years, they have gastroesophageal reflux. So there are a number of problems affecting other systems. And as you could expect from a gene that is housekeeping. So we have worked mainly on the issue of autism and intellectual disability. So to show you that what we have done is to compare a Down syndrome with Fragile X, and we have shown that Down syndrome, everyone with, and here the red or brownish bar represent autism in each one of the conditions, you see the IQ is shifted to always to the left. Within a particular disorder, the individuals who have autism tend to have lower IQ. But the shift is pretty much between 25 and 55 in Fragile X, while the majority is under 25 all the way to 40 in Down syndrome. So really, in the case of Fragile X, it's more like moderate to the edge of severe, where in Down syndrome, it's even more than that. Now, I want to show you a couple of examples. I thought about removing the label, but we don't have a lot of time, so I want you to observe the difference between these two boys. You can see the dysmorphia, particularly on the one on the left, very long, elongated head, prominent chin. But you can imagine who is the typical, who is the non-autistic, and who is autistic. There is no relatedness. There is no eye contact. And here is an engaging situation. Okay, so that's all. So what we have done is to try to answer the fundamental question, is autism in Fragile X autism or not? Is it due to the fact that they are intellectually disabled? I show you that their IQ is lower. It's shifted to the left. So maybe it's not autism. Maybe it's simply that all their functions are decreased, and one of them is social interaction, reciprocal interaction. So I was a newcomer to the field, so when you're a newcomer, you ask questions that you are more adventurous, ask questions that others who have been longer are afraid of asking. The second is, what about if it's not really overall decreasing IQ? What about if it's a problem with language? These children have language delay. Almost all developmental disorders have language delay, but what about the language delay? So we have embarked on a journey and trying to answer the question whether autism, intellectual disability, is really autism or is really an artifact of the diagnostic criteria when I apply to someone, particularly with the, you saw the moderate to lower, the moderate, severe level of intellectual disability may not work. So these are models in which we introduce data, and a lot of the data is using a combination of measures that have are related to autism, but are not in the framework of the autism diagnostic criteria, because when the diagnostic criteria for autism was developed in DSM-4, particularly in DSM-4, it was a major turning point in autism. It was in 1994. It was very early of the new era of autism. Instruments were developed to supplement that, but they were built on the same descriptions of the diagnostic criteria. So there's like a little bit of a circular argument. You don't want that. You're doing the research. If you're using an instrument that had related to autism, and you ask the question, is this really autism? You want to use instrument, at least a part of them, that capture behavior which are now built on the same conceptual framework. And this is what we have done. We have used the ABC, the Aberrant Behavior Checklist. The instrument really doesn't matter the name, but it shows you what type of, that we're using instruments that are not related to the autism criteria, the same instrument here, different scale. And we have shown that actually, this is one that is related to the criteria. We have shown that both in Fragile X and Down syndrome, IQ has virtually no contribution to we have done it as categorical analysis. We have used different type of regression models. If you want, we published a paper in 2004. If you really like statistics, dense statistics, I overkill. I went through the most cumbersome statistics to show that it's true. That I was really, I don't know what was going on. I had perhaps too much coffee, but but that paper actually has been one of the most, the paper that I have with the highest number of citations. And I was surprised in part because this is to provide the answer. And if I had to go through the extreme models of I did some stepwise regression, you don't want to hear about that unless you are a statistic nerd like me. So I have in my computer, I have a power analysis program. And sometimes at the airport, wait and say, what about if I did a study with this number of numbers? How many people are really playing those games? You know, looking at, you know, a study design. It had to be something wrong in some part of the brain, I'm sure. So we demonstrated that actually IQ, cognition doesn't. So we took, in addition to that, we took two measures of social behavior. One measure that had to do with, which is the adaptive behavior socialization, which one type of adaptive behavior. Adaptive behavior is cognition in action, in real life. And we look at specific behaviors and their contribution, a specific item will represent specific behavior. It's essentially where you learn the rules of social interaction. Is what is learned. And we look at how much they contributed to the diagnosis, to having the diagnosis or not having the diagnosis, and you can see here, and you can see all that. And actually we show that has high correlation with verbal reasoning, which is a component of cognition which is linked to prefrontal function, although it has some temporal lobe components, obviously, because it has a verbal content. So we thought that using behavior that had nothing to do with the DSM, the diagnostic criteria, we found what we call the cortical component. Then we look at other behaviors that had to do in the category that is called social withdrawal. These are much more automatic. These are more spontaneous behavior that had to do with avoidance, the fear response, you know, the response that we had to a predator, you know. Either you run or you fight, so the flight or fight response, which is very much amygdala dependent, as well as indifference, behavioral indifference. And we show that actually avoidance was, and to some extent, indifference were predictors, the second level prediction, but the first level prediction was the learned social behaviors. So we think that there are two components, and perhaps the most pure component of autism. The autism in fragile is due to this frontal lobe dysfunction, the incapacity to learn these rules. And there's a second component that may not be actually autism, may be autism, anxiety, a combination of both, that is has its origin in the limbic system. And actually, in combination with other colleagues, we show that this behavior that we were based on observation actually clustered together in a factor which is characteristic of fragile X. So this will show you how we do this. The details don't matter. So we keep asking the question, is it autism or is it not autism? And we keep putting behaviors. We collect behavior by observation or a combination of observation and rating scale, and we put them in this statistical mixer, which are factor analysis and cluster analysis. And this hasn't been published. What we have shown is that actually, as we thought, the story is more complicated. There are two clusters, and actually they are not very large, in which we can clearly, we take a bunch of kids, we take the behavior, we put them together, and we ask the question, how many groups come out of this? And the system, everything that is italic and bold are statistically significant clusters. And the two very distinctive clusters that emerge is one that has pure autism and one that has autism combined with social anxiety. And the others are mixed. Actually, there's a very important cluster that represent children who have nothing, which is your negative control. And the clusters, there are other mixed clusters like this cluster, which has a little bit of a social anxiety, a lot of autism, and a combination of both. So it's messy. It's very messy. It's not as we have found in Down syndrome, actually. But clearly, there are two distinct groups. The fact that 80 or 72% of these kids are in all together in this cluster is beyond chance. So there is really autism exists. And actually, probably what is more difficult to demonstrate is the other thing, the other things that are milder. They are all intermixed with having no behavioral problems. So to conclude, I am going to mention briefly something else that we have done to try to understand what is happening. So we keep asking the question, is really autism or not? And we came to the conclusion that it's complicated, perhaps because many of the kids have the cortical and limbic component, and those who have a limbic component more likely have this comorbidity of autism and social anxiety. They have two different entities. And a bunch of them, the majority actually, have a combination of different problems. But this is a typical, this cartoon is from a colleague in New York, which represent the typical problem that led to the belief that every male with fragile X has autism. When you go to greet them, they typically do this. Their gaze is shifted, is avoided, but also their body, the upper part of the body, you know, is turns around. So it's not only that they are avoiding gaze, because otherwise you are people who don't establish eye contact. They are looking at you, but they are looking somewhere else, but they don't move the head. They move the head. It's very interesting because we were at the Fragile X conference, and my wife told me that, so it was in a hotel, and it's always a combination of scientific meeting and meeting for the families. So the kids, typically higher functioning, were going around the entire hotel, and one of them decided that he was going to be, you know, sort of elevator operator, I don't know what's the term, because they don't exist anymore. So he was helping everyone, but he was doing it, asking the question, looking at the wall of the elevator. Where, to which floor? Avoiding eye contact. So this is, okay, avoiding eye contact, autism. No, actually it's anxiety. And we and others have shown this. By looking, we develop a scale called social approach scale, in which we measure different things like body displacement, eye contact, and we show that actually those kids who have avoidance is like almost hardwired response, but over time they really improve eye contact. Only those who over time, those that by the end of the day, and this is core system, those by the end of the day, the first day, and during the second day have high level of eye gaze avoidance are those that have autism. And actually, we have also measured their cortisol levels, and they have the same, a high level of cortisol. It's a blunter response. It's like their behavior and cortisol are the same. If you are afraid of someone, if you are nervous, you are going to have an avoidant response immediately, and your cortisol is going to go up. But when you say, well, this person is not so bad, then you start approaching the person, establishing eye contact, and your cortisol level normalizes. The kids with autism, they don't normalize the behavioral response, and the cortisol remains like without cycling. It's at the top. Instead of having a normal circadian rhythm changing throughout the day and changing in response to the behavioral interaction, actually keeps flat up, what we call blunter response. So finally, I'm not going to mention this. I'm going to conclude by saying that trying to gain, so everything that we do in terms of looking at behavior, we're trying to understand what's going on in the brain. So we're speculating that there's a cortical component, a limbic component based on behaviors that are known to be linked to these regions. But the other way, and also we're looking at other biomarkers that can tell us about the limbic system, cortisol, which is a hormone produced by the adrenal glands, is known to be related to the function of the limbic system also. So finally is to look at what happened in the brain. Let's look at the structure of the brain. Let's look at the function. A lot of the functional imaging is not possible in Fragile X and other disorders because the level of cognition of boys, and a lot has been done in girls, but there are a lot of limitations because the girls tend to be less affected. They don't tend to have autism, very low frequency. So they are not the best subjects to study this. So we're still trying to look at what's going on, but we have focused on structure because we don't need the collaboration of the child. We put them, the child, in the scanner, usually with sedation. We get the scan for other purposes also because they have seizures, other problem. And what we have shown is that actually quite interesting. A child who has fragile X, a boy who has fragile X, but doesn't have major problems, what we call typical or known, you know, has ADHD, but doesn't have a major problem, versus one that has autism, but only severe autism, severe, not the mild one. Do you see the difference? This is much larger. And actually, it's very interesting because we had the numbers. We had done these measurements, computerized, and I asked my research assistant, you know, I want to include a picture in the paper. And she went, and she pulled the first one and said, wow, that's it. This is what I like. Completely randomly, you chose a pair, and this looks like it has a swollen cerebellum. This part of the cerebellum is very interesting. This is the posterior superior cerebellum, which has been implicated in some, actually in connection with the attentional mechanism, even high-level processing of verbal information, and connects with the frontal cortex. So the theme of frontal cortex, and it keeps coming. And this particular region, the so-called lobule 6-7, posterior superior vermis, was the first finding, and is still the only one major consistent finding in autism. In individual with autism of unknown cause, this is selectively small. It turned out in Fragile X is selectively large. And this finding has been reproduced by us and others, and if you go to any review on the neuroimaging of autism, this paper is cited because what within this paper is we compare boy with fragile X with and without autism, particularly severe autism, boy with Down syndrome with and without autism, boy with autism of unknown cause and typically developing kids. And the only group that was very informative was this. Actually, we demonstrated, we confirmed what had been described in the boys with autism of unknown cause. We also reproduced the decrease in the size of lobule 6-7. So So far, this is the only consistent finding in autism in Fragile X, and we keep looking for other things. So this is the journey that we have taken, and I have told you only the more patient-oriented. We're doing some things in the laboratory, particularly where I became very interested in the amygdala and GABAergic function, and it's something that I did when I was in Baltimore, and I intend to go back to that here in Boston. So the message is the story. You think that you have the answer, and a bunch of new questions arise. And at the moment, we are answering the new questions partially. I mean, the journey that we had, for instance, the FMRP levels, the level of the protein, we never knew that we were going to find a marker for not responding. I mean, we would like to have a marker for responding to the drug, not for not responding. So why on earth the levels of FMRP in lymphocytes have anything to do with the way the brain responds to this drug? We don't know. And stay tuned. But I think that it shows you the complexity. And when you go to other disorders that are polygenic, the multiple genes are involved, or genes in environmental interaction, you could understand that the story is even more complicated. This is for one gene, with 99.5% of the mutation being the same, this full mutation. Imagine how is the story for genes like in Rett syndrome, 200 different mutations affecting the same gene. And not everyone has make it a mutation to begin with. So you're still left with 5 to 10% or more without the mutations. So complicated. Any questions? We have a couple of minutes. Yes.
Yeah, so I'm just a little curious about that expansion phenomenon or whatever. I mean, does the evidence suggest that is a gene-specific thing, or is this something that's...
The mechanism of the expansion of this trinucleotide repeat expansion, trinucleotide means is CGG, mm-hmm. It's actually a group of disorders. There is not the only, from the genetic mechanism point of view, there are a number of other disorders in which a similar expansion occurs. The difference is that those expansion may happen in exons, not only in regulatory regions. And the best example is Huntington disease, in which it happened in exon 1.
Yeah, I'm just curious.
So at the end, you have that's a reason why there is an production of this polyglutamine in the Huntington. I'm sorry.
Yeah, so I'm just curious if you say that. These patients who seem to be more susceptible to expansion? I mean, would you just say that?
No, I think that in the human genome, that particular region is very vulnerable. You see Fragile X syndrome in every single part of the world. There is no ethnic differences. And in a multi-ethnic society, the United States people have looked at them and they haven't found anything consistently. So this is a bad design. I used to say, because the parents ask me similar questions, why? And why there's no compensation? Well, I will show, sometimes I will mention our data looking for compensation. Listen, and I'm not going to say this anymore. You know, fortunately, in most of genes that are involved in development, there is some compensation. And that's the reason why we don't see so many disorders. I mean, otherwise, there would be thousands of disorders. We see only a few hundred, perhaps. And, you know, in every time that you have a disorder, it's a bad design because there is so much parallel pathways. For instance, I remember I was doing my early laboratory work, my first grant, it was called a career award from the NIH in the Department of Neuroscience at Hopkins. And everyone was very, very excited because one of the first mouse models of that in which the gene had been manipulated was of CFOS, a transcription factor, very important. It was very, very popular those days. And the CFOS mice were going around everywhere, like nothing happened. Well, it turned out that there is like at least a couple of other FOS proteins that are compensated. They are not completely normal, but they are not so abnormal thinking of the importance of the function. So when you have so much symptom, it means that the design of the pathway is not that good. It hasn't been, nature has for whatever reason, didn't design a system to compensate because it's a lot of redundancy, a lot of homologs that can't take care of the function. And so these phenomena sometimes are not recognized because it's enough phenotype that we don't know that are happening. Now, when you sequence the genome, you start seeing a lot of things that we are surprised to see. But if you look from the phenotype point of view, from the abnormal phenotype point of view, there could be many more. So I will tell the parents, when you have a CFOS, it's like a Japanese car. Fragile X is like a car made in Detroit. But now the cars are better, so I cannot say that anymore. It's not very patriotic, is all right?
Yes.
You had mentioned at the beginning that there may be a clinical test early on. Does it from a newborn or a potential there?
For what?
For detecting Fragile X.
Oh, there is actually the test is available since you can do prenatal diagnosis, right. Even pre-implantation diagnosis.
But I mean, commonly, it's not out there yet. Commonly.
Yeah, it is. Yes. So actually. Knowing the risk of premutation, some women do test for their eggs, and it has a lot of ethical issues. That as well the prenatal, because okay, you are going to do prenatal diagnosis. For what? What are you going to do if you get the information? Some people say, well, is the phenotype severe enough to justify an abortion? That child could be in the IQ of 70 range. There's no way to know based on the prenatal test.
It does help them. You don't have to rely necessarily on developmental milestones. Yeah.
It's always good to know in advance. And now the big fight in Fragile X with the new treatment that are now in undergoing clinical trials, being tested in clinical trials, is newborn diagnosis. Neonatal diagnosis is the big frontier, but in the United States, neonatal diagnosis is a state-based. So you had to deal with 50 states. So there have been a few pilot projects which are linked to the states that will be inclined to adopt the test, like California, North Carolina, South Carolina. I think those are among the first that will be involved, Illinois also. Yes.
A few years ago, there was a big push for autistic children on diets to change whether to reduce the amount that was being produced. Has that proved to be?
Unfortunately, none of the diets have been effective for autism in general, and also there have been diets and supplements in Fragile X dealing with the methylation, saying, well, what about if we modify the methylation and then this not turn off the gene? None of them have been effective. And it's the issue of getting to the brain and to the place where, I mean, I don't say that if you turn the gene on in the brain, it's important. It's only there because the gene is also needed in other places. That's the reason why they have connective tissue disorder. But when you look at the severity and the implication of the phenotype in the skeletal phenotype versus the neurologic phenotype, there's no question in my mind that you want to turn the gene on in the brain. Yes.
Yeah, when you diagnose the premutation in a child, like what's the treatment protocol? Would it be different?
There's no. We tell the parents that they we don't know that if the child had autism and we see if we have a premutation, come back with premutation. Let's say a boy with autism. Say, well, this could be a risk factor because we seem to be there is higher frequency than it should be. But the other side of the bad news is that your child has autism, and he's a boy, so when he reaches 50 or 60, he may have an additional disorder. But the good news is that people are working very hard to deal with that. And actually, a lot of the neurodegenerative disorder treatment, like in Huntington and other disorder, probably are going to provide an answer for FACTAS, not coming necessarily from the FACTAS field, because there's a lot of similarity with Huntington disease, so people keep putting emphasis on that. So we hope to have a treatment by then. So that's what we tell them, because I think it's important for them to know. I mean, it's one of the big problems of not knowing the fact that it's not Parkinson, that many of these men have been on DOPA with tremendous side effects, and DOPA doesn't work for this type of disorder because the tremor is more cerebellar, but it's not that cerebellar is like intention tremor, it's like this metric movement, but sometimes it's so subtle that it could be mistaken by the resting state tremor of Parkinson. So there are consequences of knowing the diagnosis. Yes?
Just focusing on the attention deficit and the anxiety piece, are there any connections between, say, Tourette syndrome and Fragile X? Has there been any?
Not what we are aware. I mean, a lot of the developmental disorders have connections, but it's not one that we know. I mean, there is more connection between Tourette syndrome and ADHD. There are individuals who have both disorders. And there is actually a connection phenotypically with neurofibromatosis type 1, but not with Fragile X. Yes?
I'm just curious what is the function of the missing protein?
Very good. I'm glad that you mentioned that because I didn't say. FMRP is an RNA binding protein. So what it does is to regulate messages but in different parts of the cell, but particularly neurons, because neurons have messages in different places, and one particular place which is very critical is the postsynaptic space. So many messages are translocated to the postsynaptic compartment, and FMRP is critical for allowing that or not allowing that message to translate. So for the most part, FMRP is a protein synthesis or translation inhibitor. It's holding the messages. It's not allowing them to become proteins.
Okay, so...
It's what we call them. We call them typically a break.
Okay, so in the function then is to preserve the message in after it's been received at the synaptic junction, or is it kind of a cleansing protein which...
No, it's not a cleansing, it's holding it. It's like, FMRP is known to be a chaperone. It takes the message all the way from the nucleus, all the way long distance to the, let's say, dendritic spine.
Okay.
And it's waiting for the right signal at the synapse to be produced, and then it releases. It's actually released by visual of phosphorylation, which is a general mechanism that had to do with synaptic activity.
So absent the protein, there's a reduction or an inability?
Absent the protein, there is too much protein synthesis in neurons.
Okay, all right.
And that's a problem. Particularly the protein synthesis, which is dependent on this type of glutamate receptor, the metabotropic, is out of control. Because in that particular system, FMRP plays a crucial role. And that's the reason why these drugs are trying to control. You cannot restore FMRP, at least decrease that type of synaptic activity, because otherwise the balance of excitation and inhibition in the brain goes the wrong way.
So if you have this accumulation of the RNA with the FMR, the complexes accumulating, do you actually see them? Do you see a visual?
Actually, you see inclusion. It's not FMRP. These messages, because FMRP is produced normally, they capture a number of proteins, particularly in the nucleus. They make a mess in the nucleus. The entire nuclear architecture changes, so that you see nuclear inclusions in neurons and glia, in astrocytes also. It's almost diagnostic of FACTAS these days. I didn't want to get into that because we don't have time. It's a complex story. I wanted to give you a sort of the big picture only.
I have one last question. I don't know if I missed this, but when you have a concurrence of Fragile X and autism, have you correlated it to a specific number of repeats on the CCG?
Like, that's a good question. It's like all or nothing. When you reach 200 or about 200 and the gene is turned off, it doesn't matter. You have 400, the gene is off. If you have 1,000, there are children who have, or individuals who have 1,500 repeats. Doesn't matter because it's a threshold. You reach the threshold, it's turned off. Any other question? Yes.
I was just getting back to the behavior of the children that avoid social interaction. Is it like a feedback thing? They're avoiding social interaction, so they're not learning the rules, and that's changing their brain, which makes them less likely to learn. Does that keep feeding on itself?
That's a very, very good question, and actually, I never saw it that way. That could be a mechanism on those who have the dual diagnosis, but there are so many kids, actually a larger number, who have social anxiety or high-level shyness who don't have autism. Mm-hmm. So you give them time, they warm up. And the story is much more complicated. Actually, their avoidant response is two different types we have described. One is what I call the active avoidance, more adaptive, and one the passive. The active avoidance is the child who comes to the office and see who is inside the office, me, and say, boom, start screaming or running away. That's a pretty good response. I mean, that's adaptive. And the second child who enters into the room and sits in the other corner, and he's looking at me, you know, with his peripheral vision, you know, following everything I do. And then I approach the child to examine. I'm like taking the history. He's looking at me, saying, well, this guy, I'm afraid. I approach the child to examine, and the child is dying, but doesn't move a muscle. It's simply, it's hyperventilating and doing this when I go to examine them. And I could decrease that response if I wait for an hour or two, but usually they don't allow me to do that in clinic. Yeah. I do it in research protocol. We have done that, but not in the usual clinic because we had to move. And we know that phenomenon. So I can imagine that child dying inside and the cortisol to the roof. Yeah. And it's a very non-adaptive response because you don't escape, you suffer, and these high cortisol levels are not good for your some part of the brain, like the hippocampus. But this is the way it is. And fortunately, they respond to some medication, so you can treat that. You respond to behavioral intervention as well as to some of the anxiolytics. But we're looking for targeting GABA. We think that GABA plays a very important role. And some GABA medication are being tried right now, but we're thinking that maybe a subtype of GABA-A agonist versus GABA-B, because they're much more specific. Benzodiazepines like Valium are typical GABA-A agonists. I was actually, over the weekend, passed by the Roche plant because I was doing a different project in New Jersey. And this is so sad, they announced that they're closing the plant in Nutley, New Jersey, where Valium was developed. It's one of the milestones in the pharmaceutical industry.
That was my mother's leg, where my mom worked with the Valium.
You know what I'm talking about. Yeah, I arrived to Newark and I had to drive all the way to the Robert Wood Johnson School, so we passed by that. So we're looking at GABA-A agonists. There are a few new ones that are available that we can do some work. And actually, that guy doesn't know, but I'm going to talk to him about that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for inviting me.